It's 1724, and it's one of the oldest houses in New Jersey. 1669 is the south end of the house, and 1813 is this end. If you go to the house, and then we'll go talk about the building a little bit. This is the oldest tavern in New Jersey. It was once where the corner bar now stands, up so you came in Route 40. The bar right there, this was an Indian fur trading post, 1669, and you come in and you sell fur, you buy a fur, and a place to put your, for man or beast, you could stay. So this guy builds this in 1724, he has a couple kids, by 1728, he needs more space. So they're going to tear this down in 1728, so he buys this, he probably saves 400%. He has four Native Americans disassemble it, label all the pieces, two ox drug it this mile and a half up and reassemble it to the house. So he's doubled the size of his house for no money. And then the next family to live here in 1813 actually built this side. So it's essentially built in thirds.
Yeah.
And then a lean-to kitchen went on in the 1920s, so four distinct centuries of build.
Wow.
So right now this is acting as our clock shop. Okay. Sell clocks, do service on clocks. Okay. And so this was the grand reception room here. Very rare in 1724 to have a wood panel, hand-planed ceiling, this fireplace, 1724. This was big. There were no other houses here. King George III gave Shivers, who built the house, 400,000 acres. And he said, you go out and you set up towns. And that's what Shivers did. He was a deal maker. Making the deal.
The original deal maker.
Maybe hopefully the real deal maker,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So he set up things, and the more important people we've had here, we've had William Franklin five times, Benjamin Franklin twice, Caspar Wister from Alloway's Town. If you're familiar with Wister,
yeah,
he started glassmaking.
Glass,
yeah. He started glass. There was no glassmaking in the colonies. Wister started it. So he would met Benjamin Franklin here three times and talk about making scientific apparatus for his Philadelphia location and bowls for his glass harmonica. So Wister did that in Alloway. For three harmonicas he made the bowls. And you're familiar with the harmonica, I'm sure.
Uh-huh.
Right, right. So anyway, that's an overview of the house. The house is in the middle of a sympathetic restoration, 2 years in, probably going to take another 3 years. And I do historic preservation beyond doing gilding and clock making, so anything historical. And the problem coming back here, can't find anybody, it's worth the salt. There's no real carpenters here. They don't exist. They may be a carpenter, but they don't have historic preservation training, so they're not about the dollar. Last year we did marquetry. I was trained in France for marquetry for a year. I was trained for gilding for a year and conservation for a year. So here's some of the samples that I've done in Paris. This was my sample board as a student back in 03 and 04, an old student. The larger frame was a class project also. That's carved in oak. That's a copy of a Louis XVI frame.
Hmm.
Okay, so it's all hand-carved in oak. That was probably a six-month project. Covered with gesso and then the various clays. I'm not sure if you understand the gilding process or not. But, and I've taught for a number of years gilding courses. So at the end of a week, students in a 40-hour course are going to walk home with a frame, complete looking like this. And initially, they make the frame. We find old wood, we create the molding, we create a sliding, tapered dovetail. So only the French did this. So if somebody's trying to sell you an antique frame and said it's Italian or something else, if it has sliding taper dovetails, it's only French. So what we do is we take plaster of Paris or gesso and stipple it with 21 applications, and it's mixed with rabbit skin glue. It's hot, hot. The whole frame gets that. And then when it dries for a week, then we abrade it down and smooth it down to 2,500 grit using shark skin or stingray skin, as they did in the period. If the frame is carved like this, we put on yellow ochre. And the yellow ochre goes down in all the nooks and crannies, so if you can't get all the gold down in there, imagine the lost gold, trying to stuff more gold in it. So when you look from back here, you think, oh, the whole thing is gilded, but no, you look up close, oh, you missed here, but you can't tell from the distance, and that was the key. So that's why they used the yellow ochre. The red was used to put on the high spots, so it transposes its color through the thin gold. The gold was only 0.1 micron, that's how thick the gold is. So it creates an illusion of more depth of carving by using this on the high spots, the red. That's all. But again, we're using rabbit skin glue in the whole process all the way through, okay? So imagine this is dry, we want to put the gold. All we have to do is put a little bit of water on here. It reactivates the rabbit skin glue. You take a piece of gold and it just sucks right on there. And that's how this gold is laid. And this is a patina that I put on to make it look gold. Okay, so that's your tools of the trade, so to speak. This is how you, this is the gilder's pad. You walk around with a pad and a knife. And here's your gold leaf. And this gold leaf will start out as the size of half of a dime as an ingot. And somebody with a hammer on a piece of granite will expand that out and then cut it square and put it in the book, do the next sheet. They have a lifespan of working about 7 years. Three and a half years with each hand, and they're absolutely done. The wrists are no more from the shop.
Sure. Wow.
But in Italy, it's only done in Italy and France, and it's been done that way for 600 years. They're national heroes. The country takes care of them. They're national heroes to patrimony. Wow. So they're really revered, even if they're just hammer people. You know?
I mean, there's not a machine that can.
There is a machine, and who has the machine? What country has the machine?
Probably us.
Germans.
Germans.
Germans and really? The Germans and the Japanese. That's it.
Wow.
We don't do gold. No. Okay. We do fake gold. Everything in America is fake. It's cheap, fake,
right,
junk.
Yeah.
That's America.
Right. Right.
Not leather, vinyl. You know. That's the way it is. So we don't do gold. So the finest gold I think is Italian gold.
Mm-hmm.
It's double strength, and they still do it. Yeah. But this is $100. So you take, this is a book, 25 leaves. You dump all the leaves in here, and then you start pulling a leaf out. It's very difficult. You can destroy it so easily. You get a flat piece of gold. You cut it with your knife into workable pieces. You pick up your brush, and you get some oil off your skin, and you pick the piece of gold up. You put it down.
Yeah.
Pick the piece up, and you get some more oil on your hair, and that's how it's done. So in the period, there's three distinct things happening here. When you take that carved wood frame and put the gesso, the plaster of Paris, all that time's been carving that frame crisp, what you want. Now you just filled in all the nooks and crannies with too much plaster. You put plaster, it kind of runs down and things like that. There's this distinct frame carver here. After that, it goes to the gilder. The gilder puts the plaster of Paris as we see here. Then it goes to somebody called a recutter, a totally different artist. And he takes these tools, only available in France for 500 years, and he literally cuts like this. He recuts excess plaster or gesso that's gone down into the nooks and crannies. So it's distinctive again, right. So. I have to do it all. But in Paris,
it's division of labor.
Yeah. You take the frames next door to the guys there, and they all kind of hang in the 11th arrondissement, and all the artists are there still.
Wow.
What's left? There's not a lot left. In 1750 in Paris, there was 2,500 frame carvers. There was 1,100 gilders in Paris in 1750. Today, there's two frame carvers, and there's about 30 gilders in Paris, legitimate gilders. Wow. And the Parisian government ranks them and looks and spies on them. You're talking about spying on people? The government will send you guys in to spy on me if I'm telling you a story about how this is, and if I'm using the wrong gold, and they'll shut you down. They'll come in and shut the door down. So kudos to them.
Yeah.
They're standing up for art. So whenever a gilder is using colors like here, these colors have to be vetted by the government every year, or you can't use these colors. So it's a great thing. Here we just get rid of music in the schools. We get rid of anything dealing with art, and that's just how it is. And how sad is that? But you guys are welcome to take a walk into the first room if you want. This is a keeping room. So in 2 years I restored. This is the grand reception room. The clock room is done, the keeping room, and then when you're done, I'll take you in the music room where you'll see frames looking glasses or mirrors that I've conserved from 1650 and on. So if you want to go through there, come back here, and then we'll pick it up.